Now, let's see what's new in Simulink for simulation analysis. Logging signal values for analysis is much easier now, because you can stream and log a signal with just one click. These used to be different actions before, but now they're unified. When you log a signal, that data is logged to the MATLAB workspace and the simulation data inspector. And that's nice because you have the flexibility to access your simulation data either in MATLAB or Simulink. Now, you heard me mention Simulation Data Inspector, and you may not be familiar with that. So let's talk about Simulation Data Inspector, because when it comes to visualizing signals in Simulink, most of us are happy with just working with scopes. But Simulation Data Inspector is one of the most powerful tools for analysis in Simulink. It is powerful, it's easy to use, and it's fast. So if you haven't tried it, there's something new for you. The top graph here shows the comparison of the same signal between two simulation runs. And the green band is the tolerance that is specified. The plot at the bottom is the difference of the comparison and the tolerance band. So you get that for free without writing any scripts. Simulation Data Inspector also helps you keep simulation data grouped and organized. And as we saw, it makes it really easy to compare data across different simulation runs. You can save the session to a file to share the analysis or to do it at a later time. Simulation Data Inspector also helps you replay simulation and test data without rerunning the actual simulations. The value of this is that you can speed up or slow down that data replay to inspect your simulation behavior more closely. The first step to replay the simulation data is to enable the replay controls, as you see here in the middle of the screen. Then you can replay the data and watch it run. I also mentioned that you can control the replay speed to make it faster or slower than clock time. And you can even step back and forth sample by sample. And you can also just drag the execution bar wherever you want it. What if you need to plot a signal against another to understand the relationship? That's where XY plots are helpful. You have the flexibility to visualize these XY plots as lines or scatters. And here's how it works. The plots at the bottom show the position and velocity of a bouncing ball over time. And at the top, we're going to visualize velocity and position as an XY plot. So we configure that plot area, and then we can just drag and drop the signals. And starting in 20A, you can visualize multiple XY series in the same XY plot. As I mentioned before, you can replay the data without rerunning the simulation. And you can add trend lines to these XY plots. What else can you do with Simulation Data Inspector? If you're doing physical modeling, you can stream Simscape variables directly by checking a box in the model settings. If you're working with maps, maybe for automated driving applications, you can use GPS coordinates to display location on a 2D map, and then synchronize the position on the map with the simulation data. And you see that the path history is preserved on the map. Plots in the data inspector automatically update to show the current run. And the previous runs are grouped in an archive section to help you focus on the most recent data. And it's easy to save comparison results in an HTML report. If you're sharing or documenting your work using the live editor in MATLAB, you can capture snapshots with just a few lines of MATLAB code. So that is Simulation Data Inspector for analysis and visualization. A really powerful tool, so be sure to give it a try. I've mentioned visualization a few times. A common use case is having dashboard blocks in a model to easily control parameter values and to see how a collection of signals respond. Sometimes Simulink runs too fast, so it can be hard to change inputs or visualize these dashboards in a way that makes sense. That's why we're giving you control over the simulation pace. All you have to do is click the Run dropdown in the tool strip, select Simulation Pacing, then enable pacing and then configure the pace of the simulation relative to wall clock speed. Just keep in mind that this pacing does not mean real time. So this is how you can interactively control the pace of your simulations. As I also mentioned, Dashboard blocks give you a way to interactively control and visualize the parameter values in your simulations. This custom gauge block helps you create gauges with a fully customized appearance. And here is the block in action. In fact, that's two of them. You can really get creative with the background images, the needle image, the arc color. And here you also see that the color of the display numbers change while the simulation is running based on the value of the signal. So this is a really neat way to give your models stunning displays and interactivity. If you're working with a lot of these dashboard blocks, there are connection indicators to always help you find what model element your dashboard is connected to. You can click on a dashboard block to highlight the connected block or signal, and vice versa. And you can navigate directly to a connected element from the dashboard block. You can take a set of dashboard blocks and convert it into a panel to access that dashboard throughout the model hierarchy. So you can jump in and out of referenced models, subsystems, state flow charts, and you can always see those indicators, which can be valuable for testing and debugging workflows. And when you're not using a panel, you can just double-click it to minimize it, so it stays visible but takes up less space. Dashboards are a great way to visualize signal values, but if you need a quick and easy way to see a signal value during simulation, then you can just click on a signal and that will show you the value of the signal at that point in time. That also works for buses. And you may be grouping dozens or hundreds of signals, so for buses, you can select which signals are displayed. You just have to specify that before running the simulation. These port value displays can be very helpful to debug models because they can quickly show you unexpected signal values, say if you have errors in logic or if data is not getting to where you expect it. Another effective tool for debugging and troubleshooting is the new timing legend. And this is the new version of what we used to call the sample time legend. The value of this interface update is that it makes it easier to see and understand where the different sample times originate in your model. That means that you have the ability to focus on just the blocks that introduce a specific sample time. And the interface gives you the ability to highlight specific sample times in the model. And you can highlight all the blocks with that specific domain, say only the discrete blocks. So timing legend is a really useful feature when troubleshooting multi-rate models. Simulation diagnostics are also there to help you troubleshoot your models. Now you have a quick way to get suggestions and fix errors and warnings in your models from the diagnostic messages. And some common things you can fix are algebraic loops and zero crossings. If you're triggering a warning by design, then you have the option to suppress the diagnostics as well. If you're working with a programmatic approach and you need to troubleshoot individual runs or a batch of simulations, then you can also get diagnostics with a simulation metadata object. And this object gives you information about stop events, errors, and warning diagnostics. These are a few ways to analyze and debug models, and for that, we usually look at outputs. But another important piece is the inputs that you provide to your models. And Simulink also gives you the tools you need to specify and customize inputs. The Signal Editor, which was introduced in 17b, helps you create and edit input signals for your simulations. In 19a, we added the ability to create and edit these signals graphically. Before, the only way to do that was with the Signal Builder block. With the Signal Editor, you can arrange those input signals into different sets or scenarios that you can run in succession. And if you still have models that use the Signal Builder, keep in mind that that is a legacy block with some limitations. So you can use the function Signal Builder to Signal Editor to migrate your models to the new block. Another way to specify model inputs is with the Import Mapping tool. This tool helps you connect multiple sets of signals to your models for simulations under different scenarios. And this is very useful if you're trying to keep the input data separate from the model you want to test. So if you have a model with imports at the root level, like this one, you simply click on an import block, you click on the Connect Input button, And you get an interface that looks like this, where you can import datasets from spreadsheets, map files, or the MATLAB workspace. You see the signals you can map to your model ports under a given dataset, and you can have multiple datasets to easily try out different scenarios for testing your model. On the output side, you may be working with simulations that produce large amounts of data. If you need to capture that data in a file, it's really easy. You simply check the option to log dataset to file under the configuration parameters. And check the options for what you want to log. You can do so for things like states, outputs, signal values, and so on. And all of that is logged in a dataset format contained in a mat file. When you have the dataset object, all you have to do is use the plot command in MATLAB. And that way you can visualize and analyze the data in more detail with the simulation data inspector. So if you're not very familiar or comfortable with dataset objects, this keeps the workflow really simple. So those are all the new capabilities you have available for simulation analysis. See you in the next video.